Arjuna was perplexed because Ashwatthama was to be killed as well as spared according to different scriptures cited by different persons. As a Brahma Bandhu or a worthless son of a Brahmana, Ashwatthama was not to be killed, but he was at the same time an aggressor also. And according to the rulings of Manu, an aggressor, even though he be a Brahmana, and what to speak of an unworthy son of a Brahmana, is to be killed. Dronacharya was certainly a Brahmana in the true sense of the term, but because he stood in the battlefield, he was killed. But although Ashwatthama was an aggressor, he stood without any fighting weapons. The ruling is that an aggressor, when he is without weapon or chariot, cannot be killed. All these were certainly perplexities. Besides that, Arjuna had to keep the promise he had made before Draupadi just to pacify her. And he also had to satisfy both Bhima and Krishna, who advised killing him. This dilemma was present before Arjuna, and the solution was awarded by Krishna. So, we are discussing the chapter entitled The Son of Drona Punished. So, the context here is that Arjuna captures Ashwatthama and bounds him up and brings him before Draupadi. And after seeing Ashwatthama being bound up like an animal, so Draupadi was very upset and she requests Arjuna to immediately release him because he is a Brahmana, he is our spiritual master, and he should not be disrespected in this manner, he should be released immediately. But Bhimasena and others were of the opinion that since he is an aggressor, since he has killed the sons of Draupadi, the sleeping sons of Draupadi, that is the Upapandavas, so he must be killed. And even Krishna also supported the views of Bhimasena, and Krishna also said that Ashwatthama must be killed. So now Arjuna is in a very dilemma, he is in a very confused state. What to do, whether to follow the instructions of Draupadi or to act as per the direction of Bhimasena, what should be his future course of action. So he was perplexed, he was puzzled. The personality of God, Sri Krishna said, a friend of a Brahmana is not to be killed, but if he is an aggressor, he must be killed. All these rulings are in the scriptures and you should act accordingly. You have to fulfill your promise to your wife, and he must also act to the satisfaction of Bhimasena and me. So, this is the situation of Arjuna. Actually, here there are few points to be understood. This, first of all, is Brahma Bandhu. Brahma Bandhu means one who is a friend of a Brahmana. They are called Brahma Bandhu because someone who is born in a family of a Brahmana, but if he does not possess the qualifications of a Brahmana, then he is known as Brahma Bandhu. So that's what we see in the behavior of Ashwatthama. Ashwatthama, even though he was born to Dronacharya, such an exalted personality, but still his activities, his behavior were all very abominable, as it was displayed in the act of killing the sons of Draupadi. So it is very abominable, it is not befitting the nature of a Brahmana. So he is rightly called as Brahma Bandhu. Ashwatthama is addressed as Brahma Bandhu. So since he is not in the position of a Brahmana, but still because he is related to the Dronacharya, so it is not good for Kshatriyas to kill Brahmana. Okay, a king should not kill Brahmana. King should protect the Brahmanas. That is the Vedic custom. Brahmanas are protected by the king. So that is also one injunction, scriptural injunction is there. So in that sense, Ashwatthama cannot be killed because he is related to Dronacharya. And then at the same time, here it is said he is an aggressor. Aggressor means one who tries to harm oneself, one who tries to harm another person is called aggressor. There are six kinds of aggressors have been mentioned in Manu Samhita. These six kinds of aggressors are, one is a poison giver, one who administers poison to someone. No, he is also one kind of an aggressor. See, these aggressors, for the sake of one's own self-defense, when an aggressor comes, for one's own self-defense, the person can kill this aggressor. There's nothing wrong. There's nothing wrong in killing or murdering an aggressor for one's own self-defense. This is permitted in the Shastras. Manusamhita permits that when an aggressor comes to attack us by various ways, there are six kinds of aggressors are there, then for one's own self-defense, you can kill the aggressor. There is no papa, there is no sin involved in killing the aggressor. Okay? Because generally if you murder someone, it is a sin, it is a papa karma, and you will be punished for that. But if one who is attacking you is an aggressor, then for your own self-defense, you can kill the other person. The aggressor can be killed. And there is no sin, there is no papa. And who are these six kinds of aggressors? They have been defined. There are six kinds of aggressors are there. Who are these six kinds of aggressors? One is a poison giver, one who administers poison to you. Then he's an aggressor. Okay. Kauravas did it, isn't it? Kauravas administered poison to the Pandavas. So they are aggressors. So there is one, that is one kind of an aggressor. The second kind of an aggressor is one who sets fire to the house. If someone sets fire into your house, then he's an aggressor. He can be killed. Okay. One who attacks with deadly weapons. If someone comes with a weapon to attack you, then for your own self-defense, you can attack him and kill him also. There is no wrong in it. It is not considered as sin. It's like some country, the neighboring country attacks us, or some other person comes and attacks us, then with deadly weapons, then we can, for our own self-defense, we can kill the other person. That is one of the injunctions in the Shastra. One who plunders riches, one who takes away riches, one a thief or a robber, comes and steals away your opulence, then he is also an aggressor. One who occupies another's land, if someone forcibly comes and occupies your land, then he is also an aggressor. One who kidnaps a wife, if someone comes and kidnaps away your wife, then he is also an aggressor. Just like Ravana kidnapped the wife of Lord Rama, so Rama went and killed Ravana. Not just Ravana, entire dynasty of Ravana was killed. Because he kidnapped the wife of Lord Rama. So like this, there are six kinds of aggressors have been mentioned. And for one's own self-defense, when any aggressor comes and attacks us, we can even kill them and there is no papa involved. So since here Ashwatthama comes under the category of an aggressor, because he has killed the Upapandavas, he has killed the sleeping sons of Draupadi, so he's an aggressor. He has attacked them with a deadly weapon. So then he is, fit to be killed, murdered. There's no wrong, nothing wrong in it. There's no sin involved in it. So this is the dilemma now. But again, there's another injunction that here Prabhupada writes. But although Ashwatthama was an aggressor, he stood without any fighting weapons. But here Ashwatthama's condition is that he's standing without any weapon with him. Okay. The ruling is that an aggressor, when he's without weapon or chariot, cannot be killed. And the opposing enemy, if he is without any weapon or any chariot, then we cannot attack him and kill him. We should give him a weapon and then we should fight with him. That is a Kshatriya spirit. A Kshatriya cannot attack an unweaponed enemy. We should offer him a weapon and then fight against him. And in the fight, he should kill him. So, when he is without weapon or chariot, cannot be killed. All these were certainly perplexities. So now, these are all different perplexities Arjuna is going through, because there's one injunction that he should be killed, there's another scriptural injunction that he cannot be killed, and here one side Draupadi is telling him you should spare him, other side Bhimasena is telling no, he should be killed, and Krishna is also supporting Bhimasena that he is an aggressor, he must be killed, and another side there is a Shastric injunction that he is a son of a Brahmana cannot be killed, he should not be killed. So like this, there are many conflicting, opinions and viewpoints before Arjuna, and Arjuna was completely perplexed. Arjuna was totally confused about what he should do with Ashwatthama. What should be his next course of action? Which is right action? Because, see, any action we take, that action should be, it should be in line with Shastric injunction. We cannot act whimsically. Whatever our mind dictates, whatever our senses dictate, we cannot act like that. especially a responsible person, a person on a higher responsibility, he cannot act whimsically. So whenever any actions he does, it should be satisfying to everyone. And it should be a glorious act. It should be an example for others to follow. Okay, such is the way to perform work. Okay, especially a personality like Arjuna, whenever these great personalities act, their actions will be an example for others to follow. Okay. So now, Arjuna is in the dilemma, he's in the confused state. What should be his course of action? So then here Prabhupada says in the end that Arjuna had to keep the promise he had made before Draupadi just to pacify her, and he also had to satisfy both Bhima and Krishna, who advised killing him. This dilemma was present before Arjuna. Okay. The solution was awarded by Krishna. Now, Krishna will award solution to Arjuna. How does he award solution to Arjuna? How Krishna awards solution? Because sitting in the heart of all of us, especially in the heart of a devotee, Krishna gives direction and intelligence. Okay? Who is the director of everyone's intelligence? Who controls everyone's intelligence? The Paramatma in the heart. The Paramatma is not different from Krishna. Okay? So, since Krishna is the Dihapati, this is the statement of Shukadeva Goswami. Shukadeva Goswami, before narrating Srimad Bhagavatam, he offers different prayers to Lord Krishna. And in one of the prayers, he says that Shriyapatir Yagnapati Prajapati Diyapatir Loka Patir Dharapatihi Patir Gatis Chandaka Vrishni Satvatam Prasidatame Bhagavan Satam Patihi. So here, Sukadeva Goswami glorifies Lord Krishna as Shriyampati. He is the master of all opulences. And Yajnapati, he is the master of all the sacrifices. And Prajapati, he is the controller of all the living entities. Pati means the controller or the master. Okay. So here Sukadeva Goswami is telling that Lord Krishna is the master of all opulences. He is the master of all the sacrifices. He is the controller of all the living entities. And he also says Dhyampatihi. Dhyampatihi means he is the controller of one's intelligence also. Our intelligence, see, each one of us have been bestowed with different type of intelligence, isn't it? It's not that everyone has got same amount of intelligence. See, this development of intelligence, how development of intelligence happen? This development of intelligence is also governed by the Paramatma, the super soul in the heart. The Lord who is situated in the heart, he helps one to develop one's intelligence. Okay? If Krishna does not permit, if there is no mercy of Krishna, a person will remain dumb and a fool, number one. Okay, but if someone is able to think nicely and develop his consciousness, that is also because of the mercy of the Lord. Because the intelligence is controlled by whom? The intelligence is controlled by Krishna. Krishna in the heart. Okay, that's what Krishna also says in Bhagavad Gita in 15th chapter, 15th verse. He says, "Sarvasya chaham hrudi sannivishta matta smurtir gnanam apohanam cha." Vedeshya sarve rahamayva vedhya vedanta krut vetavid eva chaham. Krishna says, sarvasya chaham hrudi sannivishta. He is situated in everyone's heart. He is not that only in the heart of human beings is there. He is there in the heart of everyone. In all life forms, in every species of life, he is present. And he says, matha smurtir jnanam apohanam cha. From him only comes remembrance. Smurti means remembrance. Like someone has got a very sharp memory. Someone is able to remember quickly. And someone may not be able to remember. Someone who can remember quickly, he can write well in the exams and score better marks. Isn't it? On what basis, in the examination, each student assumes different results. Just like yesterday, the CET ranking was announced. CET results were announced. Someone got first rank, someone got second rank, someone got 1000 rank, someone got 10,000, 50,000, like that. Isn't it? Why all of us did not receive the same ranking? That's because each one have been endowed with different types of remembrance capacity. It's not everybody able to remember on time. Someone may have sharp intelligence and sharp remembrance capability. Others may not be able to remember things. Even though some may study well, but he may not be able to remember. Because that remembrance comes from whom? Remembrance comes from Krishna. And whomever Krishna shows his mercy, whoever are recipients of Krishna's mercy, they will have higher remembrance capacity also. They will have higher intelligence also. Because the Dhyapati is who? Dhyapati is Krishna. Okay. So our brain substance, our brain tissues develop also because of the Paramatma in the heart. When the child is developing, you know, when the child's development happens, the brain development happens, and you know, all the bodily growth and development is happening. So even that brain development also happens under whose direction? Are we in control of all the development of different body organs? None of us are able to control all this. So that happens actually under the direction of Paramatma, under the direction of Super Soul. So our intelligence is also controlled by the Lord, the Super Soul, the Paramatma. And Krishna says, Matva Smrutir Jnana and Apohanam Cha, even the knowledge and the forgetfulness is also coming from Krishna only. Okay. So like this, so one who has sharp remembering, sharp memory and sharp remembrance ability, it's also because of the grace of the Lord. You should always understand that it is by the mercy, it is by the grace of the Lord, someone may have higher intelligence and sharp memory. And there are many such evidences in the Shastras which corroborates this point. For example, another place in 10th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, Lord Krishna says that, the tesam satata yukthanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadhami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite. Krishna says that buddhi yoga, that to those who are constantly devoted to serving me with love, I give the understanding by which they can come to me. That means this buddhi, this intelligence is controlled, is governed by the Supreme Lord. And those who are constantly engaged in his service, Lord gives them special intelligence, spiritual intelligence or special intelligence by which they can achieve Krishna, they can go back to Krishna. In another interesting context, when Dhruva Maharaj, when he saw Supreme Lord, like you all know Dhruva Maharaj, just a 6-year-old boy, you know, in 6 months he could realize God. Within 6 months he performed such severe austerity, and under the direction of Narada Muni. Narada Muni initiated him and asked him to chant the name of holy name of the Lord, and Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. So Dhruva Maharaj was chanting this mantra, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, and within 6 months he could see God face to face. Lord came and stood before him face to face, and you know, he had a talk with God. So at that time, when Dhruva Maharaj offered prayers to Supreme God, he offers one very special prayer. He says that, Yo anta pravishya mama vacham imam prasuptan sanjeevayati akila shakti dharasva dhamna anyamsta hasta charana shravanatva gadin prana namo bhagavate purushaya tubhyam. My dear Lord, you are all powerful. After entering within me, you have enlivened my sleeping senses. Yo anta pravishya mama vacham imam prasuptan. Like Dhruva Maharaj is saying, Yo anta pravishya means you have entered into me, and mama vacham imam prasuptam. That means you have his speaking ability, you know, that is actually amplified, that is directed by the Supreme Lord. So like this, there are many such examples are there, wherein, which states that because Lord is situated in everyone's heart and he controls one's intelligence, he inspires somebody, he gives remembrance to somebody, and then and because of that we are able to perform many different activities. Another place it is said in Bhagavatam, first canto, first verse itself, that Janmadasya tu anvayaditaratas charteshu abhignaswarat tene brahma hrudaya adikavaye muhyantiyas surayaha. That the first created being is who? Brahma. So the Brahma is known as Adikavi, is the first created being, and For him, the intelligence to create this world is also awarded by Lord Krishna only. Isn't it? Brahma could create the whole thing. Brahma is known as creator, no? He created the entire cosmic manifestation. But how he could create, who gave him the intelligence, who gave him the direction so that Brahma could create the whole universe, that intelligence is given through the Lord. Krishna says that, Tene Brahma Hrudaya Adikavaye. This is the statement of Vedavyasa. He says, Tene Brahma Hrudaya Adikavaye Muhyante Surayaha. That he is situated in the heart of Brahma and Lord shines with the lamp of knowledge. This is also given in Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, 11th verse. That tesam satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam dadhami buddhi yogam tam yenamam upayantite tesam evanukam partam aham ajnanajam tamaha nashyami atma bhavosto jnana deepena bhashvata. The jnana deepena bhashvata means he will shine the heart of the devotee with light of transcendental knowledge. Okay, so now we understood that Krishna sitting in the heart, he is a controller of one's intelligence. He awards one's knowledge, he gives one's remembrance, and he inspires the jivas to perform various activities. In fact, this is the statement of many great scientists also. Many scientists, you know, they say they could come out with many big, wonderful discoveries. You know, it's not because they deliberately came to some systematic conclusion like that. It was all just a flash. It was all just a flash of inspiration in their mind, because they are performing such great hard labor to discover something. So Lord in the heart, he will in the form of certain flashes, he will give some direction, he will give some inspiration that you act like this, you do like this, and then they could discover some natural laws, some mechanisms of the material nature. So this is all very clear that, you know, Lord is a director, Lord is a controller of one's intelligence. And he directs his directs all the living entities, more so his devotees. But now here one important point to be understood is that, see, it's not like, so now Krishna gave the direction, Krishna gave the intelligence, but now currently in our situation, in our condition, we are not in a position of taking direction and inspiration directly from the Lord. So we cannot go and talk to God in this stage of life. And that at the current stage of life, we cannot directly go and talk to God and receive direction from Him, receive instructions from God. Because currently our stage is that we are completely in ignorance, we are completely under the conditioning of the modes of material nature. And now our position is not that, you know, now we will be able to talk to God and take direction from Him. Because we are also perplexed like Arjuna. At every step of our life, we are also perplexed, isn't it? The material world is so constituted that at every step there is a danger. And all of us are perplexed. All of us are in a confused state of mind. And now we also require assistance and guidance of Supreme Lord. Because Krishna is the most perfect authority, and whatever direction Krishna awards to us, that is most perfect. Isn't it? So now, how do we get direction of Supreme Lord? Are we in a position of going and approaching Supreme Lord and talk to Him directly and take His direction, take His advice? Are we in that position? No. Because Krishna does not talk to anyone and everyone like that. See, here, whatever examples I quote here, like Shukadeva Goswami or Dhruva Maharaj or Brahma and others or Arjuna, they were all great devotees of the Lord, you know, and they are completely purified souls. So with them Lord talks. So Krishna talks with whom? As in, He Himself is saying that tesam satata yuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam. Priti purvakam means those who are constantly engaged in the service of the Supreme Lord with love and affection, with them He talks. The Prabhupada writes one place, Krishna talks with whom? He does not talk with some fools and rascals. This is what Prabhupada uses, such kind of words. Krishna talks to His pure devotees. As He Himself says, that bhajatam priti purvakam. Tesam nityabhyuktanam bhajatam priti purvakam. Like, those who are rendering loving service to Supreme God, those are already devotees, those are already purified, those are already devotees, and those are always engaged in the loving service of Supreme Lord, with him he talks. Okay, so with those pure devotees Krishna talks, because they can relate with the God. But currently, since all of us are in the conditioned stage of mind, since we are in the impure state of existence, we cannot directly go and talk with God. Okay, and we cannot take direction and inspiration from the God directly, from Krishna directly. That's why in the Shastras it is said that first of all you have to purify your consciousness, you have to purify your existence, and then once we are above this material platform, once we have raised above this material mundane platform, when we are under the internal potency of the Lord, when we come under the spiritual potency of the Lord, only then we can have direct interaction with the God. Because currently our mind, our intelligence, it is all material. Our even whatever intelligence we possess, that is also material, it is all jada, material intelligence we have. But Krishna is all pure. Krishna is completely spiritual. So with our material senses, with our material mind and material intelligence, we cannot approach Krishna. Because Krishna is divya, he is completely transcendental. Our material mind also cannot speculate and understand Krishna, because our speculative ability, our imaginative ability is also limited. Our experience is limited, isn't it? But Krishna is unlimited. So with our mental speculation, with our mental imagination also, we will be unable to understand God or Krishna. So, and our material intelligence, our buddhi, with the help of my sharp intelligence or with my past life sukruti, I may have some good intelligence, and with the help of that good intelligence, I'll try to discover Krishna, I'll try to understand Krishna. That is also not possible. Because he is beyond the beyond one's material intelligence also. That's why it is said, Atha Shri Krishna Namadi Nabaved Grahyam Indriyehi Sevon Mukuhi Jihvado Swayameva Spurat Adaha. That Atha Shri Krishna Namadi, that Krishna's name, form, his qualities, his pastimes are all divya, are all transcendental. And right now, our mind, our intelligence, our senses are all material. Both two opposite ends. With our material mind or material intelligence, you will not be able to understand what is Krishna. Impossible. You will not be able to touch Krishna. Because both are two different substances altogether. So, Sevon Mukhehi Jihvado means only when we surrender to him and when we render devotional service unto him, so that we purify our consciousness, so that we get cleansed from all material contamination, and then when we come under the spiritual potency of the Lord, only then we will be able to understand Krishna and talk with Krishna, take direction from Krishna, take knowledge from Krishna. Okay. So before that, till we become devotee, till we become pure devotee of the Lord, what one should do? One should simply follow the directions given by the spiritual master. It is same, when you follow the instructions of spiritual master, it is as good as, you know, seeing Krishna. That's called Vyavasayatmika Buddhi. So, that's why in the Shastras it is said, Adho Guru Vashrayam, that you please take shelter of spiritual master. Adho means at the very beginning. The first step in spiritual life is that you cannot directly jump over to Krishna. You take shelter of spiritual master. Adho Guru Vashrayam, take shelter of Supreme Lord. The spiritual master, who is a representative of the Supreme Lord. And under the direction of the spiritual master, under the guidance of the spiritual master, you perform devotional service. Or you engage in the service of Guru and Krishna, serving the instructions of Guru and Krishna. As a process, what happens? Anartha Nivritti happens. Like it is said, Adho Shraddha Tata Sadhu Sangha Tata Bhajana Kriya, and Anartha Nivritti. all anarthas, all the contaminations, because our heart is filled with all this kama, krodha, lobha, moha, madha, matsarya, irsha, dvesha, so many anarthas are sitting in our heart. Until unless you are fully freed from all this kama, krodha, lobha, all these anarthas, you cannot realize Krishna. That is impossible. Someone who says, no, I have seen Krishna, but he is having all kama krodha in him, then you can easily understand that he is simply cheating others. That is not possible at all. So someone who is filled with all his material contamination, at the same time he says, I have got an audience with Krishna, I can see Krishna, I can hear Krishna, that is not possible. That is cheating. So unless we are completely freed from all this contamination, unless we are freed from all these anarthas in our heart, you know, this tamoguna, rajoguna influence, even sattvaguna is also a contamination. We have to speak of tamoguna and rajoguna. So unless we are freed from all this, and you know, we have raised above the three gunas, and then come to spiritual platform, and come under the influence of spiritual energy of Supreme Lord, we cannot realize Krishna, we cannot talk to Krishna, we cannot receive guidance from Krishna or knowledge from Krishna. So, that's the reason the very first step in spiritual life is that one should take shelter of bona fide spiritual master, and under his instruction, under his guidance, cleanse your heart and mind. That cleansing process, that anartha nivritti process Guru gives us. What anartha nivritti process? That anartha nivritti process is chanting of Hare Krishna Maha Mantra and the sadhana program, whatever Srila Prabhupada has given, you should follow that. That's why Krishna, that Bhagavatam also states that nashta prayeshu abhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya. This bhagavata sevaya means what? There are two things. There are two bhagavatas are there. Who are the two bhagavatas? The book Bhagavata and the person Bhagavata. Bhagavatam is what we are studying every day. This Srimad Bhagavatam, we are discussing various shlokas from Srimad Bhagavatam and trying to understand. This is book Bhagavatam. And there is also a person Bhagavata. That person Bhagavata is the spiritual master. So we have to serve both these Bhagavatas. Serving Guru and serving the book Bhagavata, the Shastras, Vedic scriptures. If you do this, then what happens? Nashta prayeshu abhadreshu nityam bhagavata sevaya. That all the abhadra, all the anarthas in our heart, because our heart is filled with so many contaminations, no? Because of millions and millions of lifetimes of contamination. Anadi kharama phale padi bhavar nava jale. One of the Vaishnava Thakura, he says that anadi kharama phale means there is no, we cannot calculate when did I took birth in material world. I mean, when did I enter into material world? Atma, there is no birth or death, but the date when the soul entered into this material world and going on in this repeated cycle of birth and death, there is no, you cannot trace back the date of, you know, its entrance into the material world. Because it's anadi karma phala. Anadi karma phala means we have taken millions and millions and millions of kalpas. I don't know, not just, you know, yes, it is kalpas. So we are here only, anadi karma phale, and all those millions of lifetimes of contamination are there in our heart, you know, our heart and mind, or in our subtle body, so many contaminations are there, so many vasanas are there, so many desires are there. No, now, all that has to be cleansed. It's a huge amount of contamination, but it is said, the holy name of the Lord is so powerful, even though the contamination is like a huge mountain. But even one holy name, one Shuddha Nama of Lord Krishna, is like a thunderbolt. It will, one thunderbolt hits the mountain, and what happens? The whole mountain will break into pieces. So like that, the holy name of the Lord is so powerful that if you take the holy name in all its purity, then, you know, it can purify heaps of anarthas in our heart. Mountains of anarthas in our heart. Okay? So you have to begin this process by taking shelter of bona fide spiritual master and following his instructions, and anartha nivritti has to happen. You know, for that, you know, tada rajastamo bhava kamalo bhadayas chaye cheta yete rana vidam sitam sattve prasidati. That, you know, by rendering devotional service to Krishna, Vasudeva, वासुदेवे भगवति भक्ति योग प्रयोजतः जनयति आसु वैराग्यम ज्ञानयम च दहयितुकम्. That by rendering devotional service onto Vasudeva, because Krishna is transcendental, Vasudeva or Krishna, they are transcendental, they are not spiritual. By touching this transcendental person, Krishna or Guru is also transcendental. You know? So by touching Guru and Krishna, by touching Bhagavatam, it is also transcendental. By touching all the paraphernalia in association with Krishna, they are all transcendental. The holy name is transcendental, prasadam is transcendental. By constantly touching these transcendental objects, what happens? We will also rise above the contamination of the modes of material nature. Okay? And then we will also be able to come to the platform of transcendence. It's like a wire, a metal piece in touch with electricity. It also becomes like electricity. Or a metal piece put into fire, by constant touch with fire, it also becomes fiery. Like that, by constant touch with the transcendental objects, or the transcendental personalities, we will also rise above the influence of these three gunas, three modes of material nature, and become transcendental. It's a gradual process, but to the degree, to the intensity to which we associate with these transcendental objects, to the same proportion, we will also become purified. Okay. So like this, we have to take up this process of bhakti marga under the direction of spiritual master, and make progress and spiritualize our senses. Our mind has to be spiritualized, our intelligence has to be spiritualized, our senses have to be spiritualized. It means purification. Purification and spiritualization are the same. You know, when our mind becomes spiritualized, and then when we come under the spiritual potency of the Lord, only then we will be able to see Krishna, only then we will be able to hear Krishna and have a talk with Krishna and take direct instructions from Krishna. It is possible only then, not at the beginning stage. Since Arjuna was in that situation, so Arjuna was awarded the direction immediately. Otherwise, you know, one may think, you know, now at the current stage, at the current condition state of life, one may think, you know, one's mental concoction, one may consider it as direction of God. I may think, you know, now Krishna is directing me in my heart. That, you know, you do like this. He is inspiring me to do like this. But whom does Krishna inspire? Whom does Krishna talk with? You know, currently we are not in a position to take direction and inspiration from Krishna. Okay. So currently our position is that we should follow the direction of Guru. And by following the direction of Guru, only when we are sufficiently purified and spiritualized our mind and senses, then only we can, you know, associate or directly interact with Supreme Lord Krishna. Okay. So this is a purificatory process. We have to take it up. And for that, in order to make progress in the path of spiritual life also, Krishna awards them the direction. Okay. Just like we sing this Guru Puja prayer. No, that Guru Mukha Padma Vakya Chitete Koreya Aikya Arana Korihomane Ash. Means Guru Mukha Padma Vakya Chitete Koriya Aikya means the words of my spiritual master, no, is his life and soul. He does not act beyond the instructions of Guru. Guru has said, do this much, that's all, he'll remain within that limit. Does not go beyond the boundaries of the instructions of the spiritual master. Okay. So that is called, you know, vyavasayatmika buddhi, or, you know, fixed intelligence. When we act with this resolute determination that I shall act only in accordance with the directions of the spiritual master, I not manufacture my own ideas, you know, then what happens? Divya jnan hrude prakashito. Then, you know, the Guru will shine our heart with the transcendental knowledge. And Guru and Krishna are one and the same, because Guru is the representative of Krishna, and Guru carries the Shakti of Krishna. Guru is the Shaktyavesha avatar of the Lord. He is the potency of the Supreme Lord. So they are one and the same, Sakshad Haritvena. So when we stick to the instructions of the spiritual master rigidly, and we serve the spiritual master, then what happens? All the anarthas in our heart becomes cleansed, or they get cleared, and then, you know, our heart, our mind becomes spiritualized, they become purified, and then Krishna will manifest in our heart. And that time, Krishna will become your constant companion. He will become your constant friend, and he directs at every step of your life. He gives direction to you at every step of your life. He will. And again, if you become a constant companion of Supreme Lord, that is the best perfection in your life. Isn't it? Because who can be a better friend or a master than Supreme Lord? Is there anyone more greater than Krishna? Nobody. Because Krishna is Asama Urdhva. There is no one equal to him, nor greater than him. And if you take direction from Supreme Lord, because he is all perfect, if we act according to the direction of Supreme Lord, then our activities also will be perfect. There is no doubt about it. So, our goal of life should be that. You know, the goal of life should be that, you know, to make Krishna as our best friend, to make Krishna as our constant companion, and to Krishna as our beloved master, like that. So for that, you have to take shelter of bona fide spiritual master and follow the directions, follow the instructions given by the spiritual master, and to the degree to which we practice these things, to the same proportion, we'll become closer to Krishna. We'll become more and more dear to Krishna as well as closer to Krishna. Okay, so that is what the Bhagavatam is saying here. So, that's why another place Prabhupada says, real intelligence means linking with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. If someone is really intelligent, the real intelligence means what? Real intelligence means to link oneself with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Otherwise, no, if someone thinks, no, I am quite competent on my own, because of his material, if he is very puffed up because of his material intelligence, that is not good. Because, you know, there are so many such great, powerful personalities, all got lost under the influence of Kala Shakti, under the influence of the time factor. Because so many big intelligent scientists, philosophers, all came and gone, isn't it? So, under the influence of karma, we take birth in different species of life, and then we continue our material existence. But the really intelligent person, he tries to develop his connection with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Okay, this human form of life is an opportunity awarded to all of us, so that we can link oneself with the Supreme God. And only that will make us happy. Only that can make us really happy and blissful. Nothing else will make us happy, actually. Because we being Amshas of Supreme Lord, only when we get connected with Supreme Lord Krishna, we will be happy, peaceful, satisfied. You know, we all want happiness, we all want peace, we all want satisfaction, bliss in our life. We do not want any distress in our life. Because that is the natural nature of the soul. Soul is Sachidananda Vigraha. Soul by nature it is blissful, Anandamayo Bhyasat. So, because of being disconnected from the Lord, because of being not in link with God, we are all morose, we are all sad, we are all unhappy in this world. So only when we connect, link ourselves to the Supreme God, one can experience real happiness and peace and satisfaction in one's life. And the human life is especially meant for this purpose. Not that, you know, we continue our material existence and, you know, go on repeatedly suffering all the threefold miseries of life. Adhyatmika, Adhibhautika, Adhidevika Kleshas. We have to put an end for all this and experience our real nature, our Sachidananda nature. So for that, one should link oneself with the Supreme God via media is Guru. Via media is spiritual master. Through the direction of spiritual master, one can link with Supreme God and experience real Ananda in one's life. Okay. So one should endeavor, one should move in this direction, and you know, make this human life, utilize this opportunity of human birth to achieve Krishna. Okay, yeah. So any doubt, any questions are there? Any clarifications? Okay, so we'll stop here. Srila Prabhupada ki, Granthraj Srimad Bhagavatam ki, jaya.